Hello, friends. This is already the fourth installment of my presentation for YouTube, for my finance and accounting education channel. I have said previously that I will try to stick to a format. I will have for each presentation that I'm doing for YouTube two main topics. The topics for today are, of course, a teaser or a short introduction to my latest course, the one that I just published on YouTube and Udemy. Remember, on Udemy you can find my courses. They are paper course, but should you want to have access on a longer period of time to a bundle of courses, then you can do it through Patreon. You can find the links in the description of this video, and on Patreon you can have a monthly subscription. It's going from 10 to 30 euros depending on what you want to access and how you want to interact with me, based on these courses that I'm publishing. After the first and the second course, just a short review. The first course was Finance for Non-Finance, helping professionals from outside the accounting and finance understand accounting and finance. The second course that I have already published was an Excel 101, so an introduction to the Excel. Very basic, with a quiz in the beginning, helping you to establish your approximate level relative to these two courses. And of course, the third one is moving from Excel grounds, so from introduction to more advanced concepts. And I would like to present to you in the following the summary or the approach, the topics that I'm discussing in this third course. So for Excel, having moved forward from the basic concepts, we are talking about formatting your cells and typing errors. Here there are some, let's say, concepts that maybe would have found a better place in the introductory one, but they are so, let's say, I've seen that the people make this kind of mistakes more often than not. And not only the ones that are, let's say, used with working with Excel, but people that have in general profound and day-to-day interaction with the computer and various software. So that's why we are going to talk about typing errors and things like this in the beginning of this advanced course. Then we are going to talk about Excel templates. Quite simple. You can define formats that can no longer be changed after you save them. Of course, you can delete them, you can do many things with them. The idea is to have something that remains as it was initially intended on a longer period of time, and to reuse it for various needs that you have in the future. After templates, we are going to talk about the slow files. It might have already happened to you in Excel. If not, probably it will happen to you later. If you have a file that is locally saved and has links and a lot of formulas to also other locally saved files, this might not be the case. But if you are working through a network and the files are saved somewhere on a network server, it might come that you are opening a file and it's simply not working. And sometimes, if you wait long enough, 10, 15, 20 minutes maybe, it's starting to work, or sometimes it's stuck for good and you cannot do anything about it. So I'm talking about the reasons under this topic, slow files, the reasons why that happens, and a few tips and tricks how to avoid it, or at least to minimize the risk of getting it, or that time frame in which everything is frozen. Then we are talking about filtering and sorting. Quite clear, the names of these functions are, straightforward with filtering. You are filtering your data, with sorting, you are sorting it. However, there are some additional small tricks which you can use, and these tricks can help you very fast understand the data that you are trying to use without applying more advanced techniques like pivot tables and so on and so forth. Then we are talking about conditional formatting. This is a feature which was designed having in mind the potential users of reports in Excel that are not very fond of seeing only numbers, especially not many numbers, and they are, according to various psychological researches, there are people that get information better if it's presented in a visual manner, so colors, and you can find here gradient colors. You can mark the information with even the traffic lights and things like this. So it's helping the ones that are not spot on with seeing a few numbers to understand what if that is a good thing or a bad thing and so on and so forth. You can help them with coloring and many others. Then we are going to go to the goal seek. A very nice function. Sometimes you need a certain result in a cell. That cell is related to others. It can be that sometimes there are many intermediary calculations and formulas and links and so on and so forth. This goal seek is helping you by changing one item in this chain of calculation and formulas and so on, to reach in another cell the desired value. Then we are going to talk about text to tabular conversion. You will get from various databases formats, so reports in formats that are not native to Excel, and somehow they have a specific formatting that after applying a few steps, which I will detail under this point, you can obtain a usable format also in Excel, so with information on columns and rows, and as you are already used to from also from the so from the introductory Excel course, from the Excel 101. Then we are going to talk about advanced functions and mix of functions, the mighty VLOOKUP, the holy grail of functions in Excel. It's less known brother HLOOKUP, so vertical lookup, horizontal lookup. Then we are going to talk about index and match and how to use them together and what you can do, some interesting example what you can do with them. Then about SUMIF and SUMIFS as well, and I'm also going to bring in some calendar date issues. If you have information in your reports that is based on manipulating calendar date issue, calendar dates, you might already know that there are some problems with the formatting, the way you are inputting this, and how to have them in the right format so that you can actually use them in formulas and in further deriving information from your data. Then we are going to talk about financial functions. It's an absolute must, I would say, for people in finance and accounting, especially if you are working in FP&A. For the people not working in finance and accounting, maybe optional. However, if you are taking a credit or you have a leased car or you take just a mortgage or something like that, if you go to the bank, you are getting from the bank a payment schedule, and you might have wondered how come they got how did they got to those numbers which are in the payment schedule, and these financial functions will explain you how to do it also by yourself if you want to find something how much you need to pay per month, how much is the interest included in that monthly installment, how much is the principal included, provided that you have a credit, the value of the credit, you have the interest rate, the duration, in case it's a leasing with the residual value, if the payments are at the beginning or at the end of the month, and so on and so forth. Then we are going to talk about complex functions, and we are going to focus on an example about time calculation. Complex functions, from my point of view, is anything that is mixing two or more of the functions. So if you have a lot of embedded ifs, or you have a function that includes one or more VLOOKUPs, index matches, and so on, it might be that the syntax is becoming so complex it's hard to understand. However, the syntax of such functions needs to follow a logical path. What do I need to obtain? And I have here this time calculation as example, how you can solve a problem. But of course, you might have different problems, but I chose this example. How do you calculate the difference between two timestamps if these timestamps don't have the, of course I have an example, if the timestamps have a normal hour format, but if they have some sort of numeric, it might happen that they also coming from databases or from users just typing hours in a format that is not really an hour format, and how to solve this problem. The idea is to show you that things can get very complex in Excel, and that's why I have said at some point that in the Excel 101 course that it has programming like functionalities, or it can work also as a programming language. Then we are going to talk about pivot tables. You have lists. You start from the lists. The lists are not don't have any summary, so they are just rough data. You have entries, and you have various questions which need to somehow aggregate the data and present it under two or even more dimensions, and we use for that the pivot tables. After we are done with the pivot tables, we go to tables. You might say, okay, tables, that's a simple concept, why is it here? And especially why after pivot tables, it's not like that. The idea is not to have something that looks like a table, but the Excel offers a functionality of defining your information as a table, and then you can add rows and columns, and you get some, let's say, easier ways of defining this based on the existing rows and columns in your table and the calculations. And you will see that once you have put the information in this table format, you can manipulate it and call the data based on the where is it, where you can find it, on which column and row, and so on and so forth. And in the end, of course, we are going to talk about macros and Visual Basic. This is not a topic for Visual Basic experts or for VBA experts. It's actually showing a very nice and fast way of obtaining a little bit of automatization in case you need it in your Excel. The idea is, if you are having a task that is repetitive in nature and is involving a lot of similar but also simple tasks, you can automatize that, and you can do it very well with these macros. And you don't even need to know VBA. It's just a reading exercise, and you can do it all by yourself. You need not to be a specialist with Visual Basic. And I hope this will help you in case you have such tasks that are taking a lot of time, are repetitive, boring, require a lot of concentration from you. You can do mistakes. You just need to have a macro at some point, and then you just reuse it and your problems will be gone. This would be basically it about the content, what I have presented already in the in the Excel Advanced course. The second topic, which I already announced and but I didn't go that much into details, is talking about a company which was born in Romania. It's called UiPath. It was recently listed on the New York Stock Exchange, and we are going to focus on some aspects of the company, on some statements made by the owner of the company, explaining what does it do, and some other very interesting topics. UiPath is a company which was grounded in Romania. Since then it has become it became more global. Now it has offices all over the world and is listed on New York Stock Exchange. So even if originally there were two Romanian founders, one of them is the current CEO, Daniel Dines, we can no longer say that it's a Romanian company in a traditional way. And I'm saying here that first you are getting fired, then you get creative. It actually has a double meaning. First is that at some point Daniel Dines, the CEO of UiPath, said he was after 8 years he worked for Microsoft, and after 8 years he was no longer employable, so he couldn't find a job or a company as such. But now I think he did well for himself, he's a billionaire. And the second meaning is that first, this is what the company is selling, a product that is getting people fired, and that's the point. And also the reference to creativity, you'll see later why it's here in this way like this. Now let's go to the company. So as said, it was founded in 2005. It became an unicorn, that means having a worth of more than 1 billion in 2018. So after 13 years, it didn't develop very, very fast. It went through several financing rounds. Then it became a decacorn, that means that it's worth more than 10 billion in 2020. So that was a little bit faster. It multiplied its value by 10 times in only 2 years. And as of 21st of April 2021 is listed on New York Stock Exchange. So it's exactly 1 month ago. We are on 21st of May. The current market capitalization is 40 to 41 billion. It's, as we have already spoken, it's fluctuating based on the share prices. It had a turnover in 2020 of $608 million, and unfortunately a net loss of 599, so 19.9 or $520 million. I've seen an article in which they announced they are going to do some layoffs, so they are going to fire some personnel in order to improve their profitability. The story is very simple. You can trick some of the investors, or maybe most of them, on a short period of time, and it's okay if you are investing and you are developing, and you can get away with having a company at a loss, but you cannot do that with all the investors on a perpetuous timeline. We spoke about it also when we spoke about Tesla. At some point a company needs to be profitable in order to show to the investors that it has a sound business model. And I'm also curious how many years from now on, in how many years the UiPath will become profitable, if it will ever become profitable. Then we have the share price evolution since listing. So we said it's already 1 month. It launched at around $69. It reached also in April a peak of $81. It dropped somewhere in around mid-May to around 65, so the lowest. And now it's the current value is 79. Which means a 14.1% growth since the launch. Of course, for such a short time frame, 1 month, exactly 1 month, the market trends, the general environment is far more important than what the company is actually doing, because they didn't publish any financial reports in the meantime. So these fluctuations, which might seem very wide, from 81 to 65 and so on, are only market driven. For people that have a weak heart, I don't recommend that you look every day to the value or to the price of your shares, if you own shares, because this daily, intra-daily, and from one day to another fluctuations can be very ample sometimes. And the importance is the trend on longer periods of time, than especially if you are a long-term investor and not doing speculation. So you are in the storing business and not in the moving business with the shares. Now the product, UiPath, is so what's actually producing. It's producing cloud-based robotic processes automation solutions. So this robotic process automation, it's a form of business process automation technology based on metaphorical software boots, so robots, bots. So the robots are not physical, like in let's say in a car manufacturing facility, but they are just software, and or it can also be based on artificial intelligence or digital workers. The source is Wikipedia. You can look for it yourself. It has applications in banking and finance process automation, mortgage and lending processes, so also related to financial services and banking, customer care automation, e-commerce merchandising operation, OCR application. OCR are this optical character recognition, for example, reading an invoice and not only scanning it, but also recognizing the writing. Then data extraction process and fixed automation processes. So there are several applications for so far for this robotic process automation software. We are, it's part of the industry 4.0. It all started in 1784 with the first industrial revolution, which was based on steam and water power, and it evolved mechanization. Then in 1870 we had the second industrial revolution with mass production and electricity, so widely distributed electricity. In 1969 the third industrial revolution started with electronic and IT systems and a certain degree of automation and robotization, usage of robots. And now we have this fourth revolution, which is cyber, is the revolution of cyber physical systems. Now we are going to through a few saying of Daniel Dines, the CEO of UiPath. So first he said, as for the future of the global labor market, Dines said that RPA, so robotic process automation, will only increase the number of jobs. As an example, he used the situation of Japan, which has an older population from year to year. In this context, robotic system will replace people who are too old to work, thus offsetting the lack of manpower. First of all, there is a logical discrepancy here, because he's talking about increasing the number of jobs, and then he's talking about the lack of manpower. So one is one, the other is something else. Now the lack of manpower, even if the population is growing older, and not only in Japan, if we come in Europe, for example in Italy, I was reading the other day an article, the young people, so under 35, besides the fact that they have problems with leaving their homes and no longer living with their parents, they are also, most of them have very few years of working, so between 18 years and let's say 35 they have worked only a few years. They start a lot of universities, and so two, three or even more specialization. They never finish anything, and so on and so forth. And I think one of the reasons is that for this, but there are not really any jobs on the market. So saying that there is a lack of manpower, and in the same time having high unemployment rates between the young people, it's also a contradiction. Then I'm seeing that the customers are always looking to get products and services in a faster way, better, so better quality and cheaper. And since the customers want that, also the business will look in the same direction, meaning that any business will try to produce the its products, so it's what's it's selling the products or the services cheaper. Then we have the into we need to take into the consideration the condition of unskilled or low skilled laborers. They were always the victims. If we go back through all these stages of and all these industrial revolutions from 1784, they were always the victims of the changes. Of course, a low skilled laborer today is completely different than one in 1800. If in at 1800 years they were producing, let's say, bricks, so with their hands, so manually, now a low skilled laborer is considered somebody who's, for example, just typing some data on a computer, so in a specialized software, but he can only do that, so just input the information and not more than that. Then I think that with all this consideration, the real problem of the businesses is the lack of cheap manpower. So there are no cheap, especially in the most developed countries. If we are looking in the North America, in Europe, also in Asia, in countries like Japan or South Korea, and so on and so forth, is the lack of cheap manpower that needs offset, not the lack of manpower. Of course, Daniel Dines cannot say it like this. He's talking to the press. He knows that everybody is listening to him. Many are challenging the products that his company is producing, and they say that they threaten the employment of people and so on and so forth, and he needs to somehow handle this with care, and he cannot really say that the businesses cannot find cheap manpower for tasks that are otherwise also low value added, so you cannot really pay that much of a salary for such tasks. Also, I think that this RPA, so that this robotic process automation, surprisingly is filling some gaps, because if we go back, we had in the third industrial revolution this electronic and IT systems and the degree of automation, but it was not really completed, and even in highly advanced software solutions like ERPs, there are still blind spots that need to be filled, and I think that this RPA technology is filling those blind spots, which were left from 3.0 now into the Industry 4.0 revolution. Another thing is that the global education system is wrong at the moment because it does not focus on creativity. Tests that do not involve creativity will be eliminated by the software. Well, he's partly right and partly wrong. He's right as in we don't have enough creative people also because of the school. Where he is wrong, and I will explain why, is that no matter how much the school will focus only on creativity, you risk having a very large chunk of population that will have somehow the creativity trained, will not be that creative, but will also have absolutely no knowledge. He's also stating at some point that for him intelligence is more important than knowledge or experience, and I can understand that, but there are limitations also in this direction. Then he's saying that the moment back office processes in a bank can automate to a 30% extent, but in the future with the development of machine learning technologies, artificial intelligence, certain jobs will be performed exclusively by robots, and people will move into jobs that involve creativity, so again the creativity topic, or focus on interaction with customers. Let's put it this way, the purpose of such software is to move people into unemployment. There is no business or entrepreneur that can, let's say today, pay one salary to an employee for performing a certain task, and tomorrow will pay the same salary plus extra cost for automation for performing the same task. The only, let's say, salvation from this, and I have seen this by for example, by implementing ERP software, is that the managers of the business will tend always to want more. When you moved from, for example, from calculating on piece of paper with your pen and doing business cases in finance, you moved to Excel. Of course, the difference is fabulous, as in you can do a business case faster and more reliable in Excel than just doing it with a desk computer and with a simple calculator and writing on a piece of paper with your pencil. But we moved from also we moved from having one maybe two business cases to having 20, 30 changes, and so the volume of activity increased and covered, so increased exponentially and covered the gains of time through the speed of automation. So maybe this that's the only hope, that an employee that is partially automating his having his work partially automated, he will get more and more requests from the management, and maybe so his job will be saved. But talking straight and directly and taking the things at their face value, the purpose of automation is to do things cheaper through these new systems and not through people. So and because of you cannot pay for both, because that it will be expensive unless you can sell the products with a higher price or sell more products and so on and so forth. The primary purpose, and especially on the short term, will be to do layoffs and to send people into unemployment. Also, there are limitations, because we are talking about this creativity. We have already mentioned it two times. This is the IQ distribution, but I think that the creativity distribution among population is the same. Maybe, let's say, 2.2% or maybe 15.8% of the population is creative or highly creative. Most of the population, even if the education system will be oriented in this direction, will never reach the level of creativity. An employee that has his task the average employee that has his task automatized and has a lot of spare time will not automatically go into a, let's say, total quality management thinking and how can I improve things and I have ideas and things like this. He will just go on the internet and browse various websites and so on and so forth. Let's be honest about it. Then another point here is that of course that the businesses want to do things faster, better and cheaper, just as we said, because the customers want to have the products and the services in this direction. So let's just say that the way things are being said by Daniel Dines, okay, he's just as he said, he's talking and he's writing these things also in IPO's prospects, and he's talking to the press, and he cannot say the reality, but on short term, his software is about laying people off, and the fact that there is not that much cheap workforce on the market and so on and so forth, but he needs to somehow pack this in a friendlier and in a better way that can be communicated to the press and to the public. It's only natural to happen this way. Also, think about there was another example, which is okay, it's going away from RP, but is in the same direction with an AI, about having these automated cars that drive themselves. So it should be an AI behind. Tesla is doing some steps in this direction, not very fortunate. At some point it will come that there will be an artificial intelligence in a car and the car would be able to drive itself. And if we do that with the cars, you can also do it with trucks, of course. And the simple question is, if you take a, it can be a young one or it can be a 50 years old truck driver, you cannot just turn him so like in one night from being a truck driver, just throwing him away from his truck, putting an artificial intelligence and turning him from a truck driver to into a software developer or a system engineer or a AI expert or an automatization expert and things like this. I mean, we need to be realistic and think that these people are unskilled or low skilled, it depends, and you cannot do these changes very fast for them. And after we have talked about this, just some general considerations, so not really related to UiPath, but about automation, robots, AI, digitalization, and all this big data and everything that's currently cloud software, what's out there. The limitations are that there is this middle class of population, and many of them are small owners of businesses. Not all of them, also skilled employees like managers and so on are considered in this middle class. According to OECD, the SMEs are the predominant form of enterprise, so they are accounting for 99% of the firms, and they provide also 70% of the jobs. And on top of that, they are major contributors of value creation, generating between 50 and 60% of the value added on an average. That's according to a study from OECD in 2017. These numbers might have changed a little bit in the meantime, okay, so there are already 4 years. But in order to implement automation, you just need a large number of employees that are doing repetitive and simple tasks. Yeah, so it's the same ground for externalization, so taking your department and sending it to China because there the employees are cheaper. In a small business, if we take my example, if you have an accounting department with 2, 3, maybe 4 people that are doing all the required tasks, so they are taking care of the bank, everything that's related to the bank, petty cash, supplier invoices, customer invoices, payroll, and so on and so forth. So all this month or period closing, year closing, and so on and so forth. The tasks are complex and diversified enough not to be good for such not to be a good ground for such automation. If you have now a large company, like talk about Procter & Gamble, where you have an office or more offices where there are like 30 or 40 people that are just inputting invoices, so they are just booking the invoices, which are pretty standard, and the products on the invoices don't change that much. You have the mass and the repetitive aspect of the work, then you can think about externalization, automatization, and something like that. However, be worried that that applies to only 1% of the firms, 30% of the jobs, and 40 to 50% of the value added in the economy. Also, for small businesses, it might just be that the software and all these solutions, including ERPs, so from Industrial Revolution 3.0, but moving to 4.0, all this cloud computing and artificial intelligence and big data and robotic process automation from UiPath and so on and so forth, these solutions might be too expensive compared to just paying 2 or 3 people that do the same things manually, let's say. What is interesting is that somehow the economic context is favoring concentration, so moving away from SMEs to large companies. You can already see it in the value added, so although they have 70% of the jobs and 99% of the firms, they are not producing more than 50 to 60% of the economic value added. So 40 to 50% are concentrated in big companies. And this favoring, unfortunately, also the COVID pandemic, what just happened in 2020, and it's still going in 2021, it's favoring the concentration into monopolies, online business models, and for example, the hardest hit was taken by local shops, small shops and things like that. They are usually family owned, all the family members work there or other workers, and everything is moving into the direction of online. Certain companies, for example, one that starts with A and ends with Amazon, it's one of these companies that are online and they sell all sorts of things, and they even announced they want to do barber shops in no time. I don't know why, because that's not that much added value and it might not be a good business opportunity for them. But these are the, let's say, the conflicting trends and in the background for this Industry 4.0 is here. It will happen for sure. Will it cover everything? Probably not. Just to be honest, there are businesses that will not be that much involved because they are also not not supported or not, let's say, that much oriented in the in this direction. Let's think about let's say a small bakery. Between baking very good bread, I'm quite sure that the baker will never be that interested or focused or have gains from thinking or working with big data or something like that. I mean, it's totally ridiculous to think in this direction. And that being said, we are done for today, for this presentation. Just remember to like, share, subscribe and even comment this video. You can find the courses that I have already introduced to you, including the one from today, the Advanced Excel on Udemy, with a paper course schedule, or on under Patreon. There you have the opportunity to have a monthly subscription plan and to get access to all my courses and my presentations. Thank you very much for following me, and I look forward to the next installment of my presentations. Thank you very much.